worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Friends, the Four Noble Truth, Chatari, Arya, Satyani, which is the very core of Buddhism, are the following. 1. All this and such is suffering, dukkha. 2. Craving is the cause of suffering, dukkha, samudaya. 3. Absence of craving is the end of suffering, dukkha nirodha. 4. The Noble Eightfold Way leads to the end of suffering, dukkha nirodha, kamani patibhaga. The Noble Eightfold Way leading to nibbana is simply this: right view, sammatitti; right motivation, sammasankappa; right speech, sammavacca; right action, sammakamanta; right livelihood, sammajiva; right effort, sammavacama; right awareness, sammasati; and right concentration, samma samadhi. But what is right view? What is this initiating and thus crucial right view? Right view is threefold. 1. Right view is of ownership of karma, like this: all beings are owners of their karma, inherit their karma, are born of their karma, are created by their karma, are linked to their karma, and any intentional action, any karma they do, whether good or bad, the effects of that will be theirs only. Follow him like a shadow that never leaves. This is right view. 2. Right view of the 10 phenomena is like this: giving alms has good future effects. Any self-sacrifice results in pleasure. Small gifts and donations are also advantageous. There is resulting fruition thus of any good and any bad behavior. There is moral, ethical efficacy of any relation to mother and father. There is this world, and there are other dimensions, other worlds. There are beings who are spontaneously and instantaneously reborn. There exists good and pure recluses and monks in this world, who by having followed the right method of practice themselves, by their own superhuman abilities, have directly experienced these other worlds, and who explain them and thereby make them known here. This is right view, too. 3. Right view of the Four Noble Truths. Right view of this is suffering. Right view of craving is the cause of suffering. Right view of absence of craving is the end of suffering. Right view of the Noble Eightfold Way leading to the end of suffering. This too is right view. And for further study on right view, Majjhima Nikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, number 9, is Sammaditti Sutta, the discourse on right view. This and such is right view, Sammaditti.
Hello to you, friends. This is video log number 27 about how to regain, to pick up this motivation for training and thereby avert the backsliding into detrimental, disadvantageous, gradual but inevitable downfall. This was actually, this is motivated by a Burmese practitioner's question to his or her teacher, which goes like this. Please give me some tips for regaining motivation for meditation again. And then this Burmese monk's, I think, fairly qualified answer was the following. At such time of lax backsliding, then the meditator should encourage, lift up, elevate the mind by reviewing 11 things. Which 11 things? 1. The suffering, dukkha, inherent in birth. 2. The suffering, inherent in aging. 3. The suffering, inherent, imminent, in sickness. 4. The suffering, inevitable, in death. The suffering, inherent, in the states of loss, in the states of deprivation, abhaya, the fearful states. 6. The suffering inherent in the past, rooted in the round of rebirth. 7. The suffering in the future, rooted in the round, endless round of rebirth, going in circles, going nowhere. 8. The suffering in the present, rooted in the search for food, money, livelihood, housing, and so forth. 9. Reviewing the Buddha's quality. 10. Reviewing the Dhamma's quality. And 11. Reviewing the Sangha's quality. What is the suffering inherent in birth? And what is birth? The Buddha said, whatever birth, delivery, descent, coming to be, appearance, emergence inherent in the five clusters of clinging, the khandhas, or acquisition of the senses and abilities, in whatever form of being, in this or that group of being, at this or that level of the 31 levels of existence. This is called birth. For the human being, it is being basically incarcerated for 9 months in another person's belly and then being pushed out in slime through an opening that is smaller than the head. So the bones of the skull of the baby has to go in over each other, huh? Normally lie like this, but then they have to go in on each other. So it's being pushed through a hole that is smaller than the diameter of your head. Very painful. And then as soon as there is this birth, then there is also the inevitable, never escaping death and the suffering inherent in that. This fact of birth, the suffering inherent in birth, rebirth, endless rebirth, is the first fact one should often reflect upon, repeatedly, repeatedly, repeatedly. The suffering inherent in aging, yeah, whatever aging, and what aging there is, this is the decay, the wasting, the graying of the hair, the wrinkling of the skin, the decline of the vitality, the broken teeth, the hanging breast, the pot belly, the loss of strength, the weakening in one's abilities, in this of that group of beings, that is called aging. One should also reflect, I'm subject to aging. I have not gone beyond aging. And similar with birth, I'm subject to birth still. I'm not gone beyond birth. This is the second fact one should reflect upon repeatedly, again and again. I'm subject to aging. I'm not gone beyond aging. As this is a fact, I will keep experiencing aging and the suffering inherent in aging and decay, potentially forever, until I step out of this round of rebirth. The suffering inherent in sickness, and what is sickness? That is heart and vascular disease, stroke, heart attack, cancer, chronic lung disease, accidents, Alzheimer's, dementia, obesity, diabetes, HIV, influenza, pneumonia, chronic kidney disease, bone, muscle and tendon pain, sleep, sexual and eating disorders, depression, anxiety, stress, compulsive behavior and suicide. That is sickness. And again, one should reflect, I'm subject to sickness, to illness. I've not gone beyond sickness and illness. If I keep on not meditating, not training, then I will stay in this samsaric round, and then I will keep on experiencing sickness and illness, potentially forever. This is the third fact one should reflect upon again and again, often and often. The suffering inherent in death, and what is death? Yeah, what is the deceasing, passing away, breaking up, disappearance, dying, death, completion of time, breaking up of the clusters of clinging, the casting off of the body, the loss of form, the interruption of life, inherent in the various beings in this of that form of being, of whatever form of being it is, and the 31 levels of existence, that is called death. And again, I'm subject to death. I have not yet gone beyond death. This means I'm not free of death. As long as I keep on bossing around in this samsaric round, then I will re-experience birth, aging, sickness and death again and again and again and again, until I make sense of and pick up the motivation, the strength, the effort, the endurance, the stamina, the stoic perseverance for completing the Noble Eightfold Way and escaping all this birth, aging, sickness and death by going scot-free forever. One should also reflect, does this going nowhere in circle ever lead to happiness? Does birth, rebirth ever lead to happiness? Does repeated aging ever lead to lasting happiness? Does repeated illness, sickness and death ever reoccurring ever lead to lasting happiness? Obviously no. is self-evident that it can never lead to happiness. It can only lead to suffering, dukkha, bad states coming back again and again into the future. The suffering inherent in the states of lust, apaya, this is being reborn as an angry demon, asura, in constant violent conflict. If you think about what's going on in Syria, people being gassed by neural gas, dying basically in a, with foam out of their mouth by their own king or dominator. This is what the asuras experience for millions of years, constantly. This is one of the states of loss or fearful states, being reborn as asura, angry demon. Being reborn as hungry ghost, weeping and wailing for millions of years, being unable to get anything to eat, or unable to gain any satisfaction whatsoever. Being reborn among the animals, Titakana Yoni, which is fearless and homeless forever, are usually being eaten by other bigger animals than themselves. Secondly, animals are unable to improve their own situation. They cannot do good things to others, or very little good things to others, so they can lift themselves up. That's why we say the human situation is happy, because we at least have the opportunity to do something good. Though in 96.4% of human beings, this opportunity is not utilized. That's, I think, the biggest tragedy among the human beings now, is a complete lack of ability, almost complete lack of ability to see, to perceive, to understand, to comprehend the necessity, crucial necessity, to avoid doing evil and to start doing good, significant good, lifelong, lifelong, day in, day out, in order to escape these fearful states of loss. And being reborn in hell, Niraya, beings which lives in unimaginable torture, torment, agony, excruciating, cutting up, chopping up, crucifixion and impalement, pain, suffering and anguish. This is the fifth fact one should reflect upon often, again and again and again and again. The suffering in the past rooted in the round of rebirth. Once you think, are billions of billions of billions of universal cycles, have I already suffered this potentially endless round of samsaric suffering caused by rebirth? Did that going nowhere in circles ever lead to lasting happiness? And the answer to that question is a resounding no, it did not. Though that is what might is searching for, and that is what is the purpose of all conscious life. This is the sixth fact one should reflect upon often. How come that this body and mind already have spent billions of billions of billions of universal cycles, each lasting 150 billion years, each containing numerous rebirths, at usually in the lower states and very rarely at the higher states, basically going nowhere in circles, searching for happiness without finding it. The suffering rooted in the future round of rebirth, once you think, are billions of billions of billions of universal cycles of rebirth, will I continue to suffer going around in this samsaric round, which is potentially endless, potentially infinite, if the being doesn't comprehend that it is caught up in a glass house, in a mirror house, where it is fooled by its own illusory illusions about what happiness and the purpose of life is. Recreating intentionally karmic future and thereby continuing this round of rebirth. Does that going nowhere in circles ever lead to lasting happiness in the future? No. Either. Neither. Nope. Never. However long one makes this future, however many billions of existences and billions of eons one continue in this round of rebirth on the 31 levels of existence, one will never reach lasting happiness. One will never step out of rebirth, aging, sickness, and death, and thus reach the irreversible, absolute end of suffering. Never. Not possible, simply. The suffering of the present rooted in the search for money, housing, and food. Billions of billions of billions of universal cycles have worked, stressed, and being enslaved in meaningless, absurd monotony of pumping up, maintaining life, family, house, social status, food, pleasure, entertainment, and what have you. Does this going nowhere in circles ever lead to lasting happiness? No. Obviously not. This recreating sense pleasure by going to work and maintaining a certain level of social security does not make sense, because it does not lead to the goal of lasting happiness. It does not lead to the goal. Nine, reflecting upon the quality of the Buddha. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Buddha. Consummated in knowledge and behavior. Totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be tamed, both teacher and guides of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and enlightened was the Buddha. This is the ninth fact one should keep reflecting upon again and again and again and again. Reflecting upon the qualities of the Buddha Guna. 10. Reflecting upon the Dhamma's quality. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma. Visible right here and now. Immediately effective. Timeless. Inviting each and every one to come and see for themselves. Inspect, examine, and verify. Leading each and every one through progress towards perfection. Directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. This is the 10th fact one should reflect upon often. This sublime, supreme, absolute quality of the Dhamma leading to the deathless Nibbana. Nothing else can do that. 11. Reviewing the quality of the Sangha like this. Perfectly training is the noble Sangha community of the Buddha's disciples, training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore do these eight kind of individuals, the four noble paths, deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation with joined palms, since this noble Sangha community of the noble disciples is an unsurpassable, a forever unsurpassed field of merit, probability. In and for this world to support, worship, respect, protect, give to, and gain from. This is the 11th fact one should reflect upon often. Such 11-fold repeated reflection regains motivation for the training and meditation. It regains a sense of urgency, samvega. It stabilizes the training, so it becomes a mode of living, a habit of life. And that brings about detachment, liberation, release, freedom, and thus ease, contentment, gratitude, and sweet, blissful happiness. Yeah. And as icing on the cake, we take three Dhammapada verses of the Buddha. Being alert, alert, acutely alert, always, is the way to the deathless. Neglect is the way to death. Those who are alert die not. Those who neglect are as if dead already. Dhammapada, verse 21. The wise ones, ever meditative and steadfastly persevering, alone experience Nibbana, the incomparable freedom from all bondage. Dhammapada, verse 23. Ever grows the glory and fame of one who is enthusiastic, aware, and pure in behavior, comprehending, and self-controlled, righteous, and alert. Dhammapada, 24. So was the Dhamma drop today. I certainly hope it regains your motivation and my motivation and an innumerable number of beings' motivations in the future too. Thank you for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution, especially to the foremost regular donors who give every month, the other Dayakas, supporters, food givers, and meditation hall supporters. May you indeed enjoy a nice, noble, and beautiful day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.